Not only am I running a marathon, I'm running a marathon in one of the most isolated countries in the world.
They're actually going to follow me, so I'm not going running on my own.
I was definitely a little worried. You don't know much about this country, you know, nobody does. If I win a gold medal, I mainly win it for me. It was my work. For them, they're winning it for the country.
Everything here is monitored. You will eat this, you will train like this, and you will be the best.
It's like these two parts in my head. The one is telling me, hey, the things you read about this country are not true. On the other hand, I'm like seeing these weird things.
7 a.m. marathon day. There are thousands of people lining up.
Whoa,
this is actually happening. Hello!
Hello. How are you?
Oh, mate, it's good to see you.
So good to see you. So, Aimee Fuller, an Olympian snowboarder. Is that correct? That's the title.
I think so. I would definitely go with that. I might even claim two-time Olympian. Why not?
Oh, sorry. Two-time British snowboarding Olympian.
Yeah, so that's right. That's
seen
right.
Seen all sorts in all sorts of countries.
It almost feels less strange than when I last saw you, really. Yeah, I think you were maybe in Beijing like 36 hours before to get all the camera kit and stuff.
Do you remember that flight? Talk me through the flight. So Beijing to Pyongyang.
Okay, so I'd say the weirdest thing was probably landing in Beijing. Yeah, okay, this is cool. Yeah, looking forward to this. Going to sleep, then waking up knowing that I was going to leave all of my belongings and valuables in a vault in China, and then just leave them there with no communication. So I remember just very, very vividly sort of saying bye to my phone and my laptop and being like, right, this is it. And then arriving at the airport in Beijing and being like, I wonder if, you know, just the concept of getting on a flight to Pyongyang in itself is strange. So I remember like walking around like, oh, I wonder if the check-in's going to be different. And there's all these things that you build up in your mind. And actually the process of taking the flight was relatively normal. But I remember just before we were due to get on the flight, there was some sort of strange happenings. I think, did you get chatting to the sort of tour guide there? He was saying in the airport,
Was this dude who kind of found us, who was, he's been to North Korea, I think he said something like 112 times or some bizarre number.
Yes.
Yeah. I think he was British and I think he sort of does these tours to North Korea. And he's done, and he was one of the organizers, it turned out later, of the actual marathon, if I remember correctly. So it's like, it's a first contact, from someone from there, kind of from there. And we're like, so, like, are we allowed phones? Not really, you have to get this SIM, which costs like $400 per person. We're like, great. And it was the first sort of link. And he was like, it'll be fine. So we board the plane.
Yeah,
There is food served on the plane.
Well, I was really happy because I was next to you and then the director, Carl, which was nice. And I don't think I've ever been so happy to have a middle seat. But before we sat down, I got on the plane and I had my GoPro sort of like snuck.
Yeah, so to explain, Aimee's sort of filming in parallel to us. So we had the big proper cameras, and then Aimee and Mimi, who is the other runner who participated in the 10K race, we gave GoPros to both of you, and you were meant to film kind of like a diary.
Yeah, so I had my GoPro on, and I was like trying to be stealth. I was like, I'm just going to try this out. You know, we're not like in North Korean territory yet. We're still in China. So I was like, I'm just going to film. And there was sort of like the business class segment of the plane, like there is on a normal flight. And the air hostess like just grabbed me by the calf and was like, delete, delete, delete. And I was like, whoa. Whoa, okay, this is real.
And it's interesting, right? At the same time, there was nothing that abnormal or secretive on the plane. I think it's their perception as well. Why are you filming? You shouldn't be filming. Because, it was a plane. It was old plane, you have to say. It's sort of like 80s Russian. It's kind of a bit noisy. And the food served was sort of like a hamburger, which I thought is ironic. They literally serve hamburger on a flight to North Korea.
Yeah, no, I didn't eat anything on the flight. And I remember just sort of being like really relieved when we touched down, because the flight, you know, it was crickety. The cabin crew were quite aggressive, I would say, in the way that, you know, it was very like, get on, go, go, go. And Richie, remember, they were kind of like pushing us down into
it's
the seats.
Time, Aimee, it's time. Time's
it's
much.
It's going.
There was also a whole classroom, I think, of DPRK, which is North Korea, DPRK and kids. I think they were visiting Beijing or on some also sports competition. There was like half a plane was kids. Talking about the entire trip now, looking back at it, what was not maybe like you expected?
I think it's so hard to sort of almost like imagine what it's actually going to be like. I think the biggest shock for me, one of the biggest shocks was even still landing, sort of being escorted through the airport as VIPs, you know, guests of the Olympic Channel. But then driving away from Pyongyang, which if you imagine Heathrow Airport, and say South Kensington, that distance, you know, on the tube in London terms. And just seeing people at the sides of the road, like all in black clothes, no branding, everyone just like marching. And I remember going like, hey, like, why is everyone walking? Like, they're walking really, really, really far.
But exercising.
There doesn't seem to be like any shops or... like, where are they going? And he goes, oh, we like to walk here because it's good for the environment and we want to keep everything clean. But, you know, obviously further on into the trip, I learned that nobody has cars there because there is such great poverty. And the only people that have cars are, like, diplomatic members of the government there. So,
plus,
you know,
there is some form of taxi, I think. So there was some... sort of, you rarely have a private car, but you have this sort of semi-public transport, which is basically taxis, which are a bit or slightly more richer.
But I think just seeing like so many people walking just was mind-blowing, because it wasn't like they were just walking a few miles either. It was like miles, miles. So that, and then of course it has to be the Olympic weightlifting team in the food factory on the roof. I mean, that whole scenario, like when I explain that
talk us through for those who haven't seen it.
Okay, so for anyone just joining, by the way, we're talking about running in North Korea, because I suppose
I'm gonna put this trailer. I think it shouldn't obstruct the sound. It's just gonna play in the background. It's just
okay,
like
cool.
A silent trailer.
Oh, wicked. So running in North Korea, one of the strangest moments for me was, I think it was on the first day, and we went to a food factory, and it was their pride and joy, this food factory. And they wanted to show us how they make French bread and, you know, all these different types of sweets. And I got stuck into some chewing gum. I'm pretty sure, Edgar, you had pretty much everything going. But there were all these different floors of the factory, and we ended up on the roof of this sort of like old factory. And it was something from this old factory to like a tropical oasis of a swimming pool.
Like a proper good spa. not yeah, this, like, but it's kind of like half of this shot. That's like the actual spot. But
oh, it was so yeah. bizarre. And I remember thinking, oh, that's strange. There's a swimming pool on top of a, you know, like a sweet factory. It was almost like something out of Willy Wonka. But then you had like security guards either end of the pool, inflatable boats, and then you had the Olympic weightlifting team on top of the swimming pool, like in inflatables, playing like kids, like they were adults. And then they were like drinking beer and eating sweets. So it was like, that was their day off. And it just, the yeah. whole scenario, yeah. the fact so it was on, yeah. on the roof was just so strange.
It's a factory, basically, as some coming from like a socialist background will know, it's like a factory for the good workers, basically. So if you were good, you get a ticket, basically, to that factory. I think they said the best from each department gets 2 tickets a month. So as in family tickets. Yeah, so this is like a kind of, if you win, if you're the best manager or the best kind of employee of the week, I think, then each gets a family ticket, so family and friends can come. And then obviously if you're Olympian, you also get, I mean, like, do you get a free spa treatment, Aimee, on top of a factory?
I mean, I can safely say I've not experienced that yet, but I did in North Korea, and there was more than just
Team GB.
There was more than just, like, you know, sweets available. There were chicken feet, if you remember.
Yeah, some meats. I remember some salami, sausages, that kind of stuff.
And it was
beautifully served as well. I think there was 4 or 6 tables full of that food. It was sort of maybe just 4 people in the team, then us as guests, I guess, and then the factory director joined us. And that whole segment is actually in the film. If you're going to watch on YouTube, guys, it's running in North Korea. Is you just search that and you'll find it. And that segment is there. I want to ask you, do you want to go back? Would you go back?
You know, so I felt towards the end of the trip like I sort of created a bit of a bond with our tour guides, Lee and O. And
Mr. Lee and Mr. O.
I felt like almost like, you know, quite thankful to them for, you know, making our trip like safe and productive and as positive as it could have been with what we saw. And if I could give back to them, I would love to, in the sense that, you know, take some of their athlete snowboarding. I would consider doing that for sure. I wouldn't say I'd rush back to do another marathon, but I would go back to sort of help try and support and build the snow sports community for sure.
I want to ask you, there was a question. One second, sorry. Yeah, from Anastasia Butrim, which I think would be interesting for you to answer, Aimee. Do you see the question there?
Yeah.
Did you get to speak with any locals, and in brackets, unrelated to your job there?
Unrelated to your job there. I mean, we did get to speak to them, but I think the language barrier was so strong that sport was really the only way we could connect and relate. So we were the morning before the marathon, or the day before the marathon, sorry, we got to go for a run with some of the athletes, and sort of the only way to really speak to them was through movement. And I think that was the really defining moment for me, is that like sport is a global language, and it's a fantastic way of connecting with people and breaking down barriers, regardless of like race or, you know, language. So I'd say that was the closest we got to it. Although I sat around the table full of North Koreans after the marathon, you know, we still had a translator. So I think actually moving with them was the best way that I could connect with the local people.
And they're pretty decent distance runners, it turns out. They're mainly distance, I think, due to health and sports reasons. But yeah, it was nice to see as well, kind of running was similar. But then I remember vividly the stretching routines afterwards were very different. You went sort of full yoga routine, and the girls were sort of like, okay, I guess we need to sort of stretch a bit after the run. There's another question from Vladimir's. It was, what did you like in North Korea?
I'll tell you what I really liked. I liked being away from my phone. I liked leaving all of those distractions and outside noise away, and then just being really, really present with the crew and actually filming the documentary. For me, that whole experience was the most powerful one, to, you know, like solely just be focusing on that and having no distractions from the outside world, and the bonds that were formed and created within the team with having no distractions. It just made me feel as though we were a real unit there together. And yeah, we were just so present. It like gives me like tingles talking about it. And, you know, there's moments from every single person on that trip that I can think of that make it special, just because of what we did. It was so unique, you know, and I think it's very hard to explain that because it is different. And I love the experience of filming, you know, a documentary. I'd never done that before either. So to be around guys like yourself that have so much experience in that world was really cool as well.
I'm going to finish, Ames, with you on the most vivid memory.
Can I say three? I'll keep it short.
Yeah, do it.
The dancing ladies was two, because that was like a moment where it was just like us and dancing ladies
so
in
dancing
a restaurant.
Ladies, just to quickly explain, we walk into this restaurant, which is a part of that factory as well. It's the factory director invited us to a dinner next day to the restaurant. We walk in. It's a relatively big sized restaurant, and there's only one table served for us. It's Lishila in the middle, spotlit, just for us. We go there, we chill. And then there's entertainment. It's a girl band playing instruments. And then one of the songs, they get up and invite the gentleman of the table to dance.
That was definitely one for the memory bank. And then the other one was probably just, you know, the actual, the physicality of the marathon and the lengths of the streets. You know, it really wasn't a case of like an exploration route. It was very much a case of being out and back, and you're running through the center of Pyongyang. And, you know, on the way back, there was just no one there. You know, it was just miles and miles and miles of just like these huge roads and no
people.
Your
first marathon, like, right, as well.
Yeah, I'm just like, da 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 da, like, I'm going. I can see like one man like 500 meters ahead of me. That's it. So, yeah, I think just like the grand scale of the course and how big Pyongyang, you know, actually is in terms of its architecture. And like that moment, just being there, being like, this is surreal. Like, what am I doing? You know, just keep running, Amy. Just keep going. But if I stop, no one's going to see.
Just do a little loop. Yeah. World record.
No, right. I definitely would have got caught out.
Ames, so good to hear from you. And I'm going to connect Carl, who is requesting, and we're going to chat with the director. Carl, tell me, do you want to go back?
Yeah, I'd go back. I'd go back tomorrow, because I think what we had there was a really brief experience in a really interesting place. And, you know, no one goes there. And certainly no one goes there with the sort of access we had. And it's really interesting, once the film went out, on YouTube in particular, there was sort of this diversity of reaction. Some people saying, this is a piece of incredibly toxic propaganda. What the hell are you doing? And some people saying, this is beautiful. It's a celebration of sport and running, and how great to get a glimpse inside this hermit, you know, kingdom. And I'm sort of delighted with that response, in that, you know, I'm not in a position to bring back a definitive response to the situation in North Korea. But, you know, we were privileged to meet some of the people who live there and are part of the sporting culture, and we were, you know, I think trusted with their views and opinions, which are their views and opinions, and I think we tried to be true to that, and the experience of the athletes who were traveling with us. The reason why I'd like to go back is because I think we just scratched the surface, and it'd be great to return there for longer.
Do you have any info what did the locals think of the film? Has there been any?
I mean, the only response I know is that the Olympic channel and the people who are involved in the Olympic organization and the Olympic movement enjoyed it and were happy. And,
okay.
And,
you mean the DPRK Olympic or
no? The Olympic organization. But I think that's why it was so interesting once it went onto YouTube, because you could actually get a response from people who live in Korea or did live in Korea or have relatives or family living in Korea, and North and South. You know, in the Democratic People's Republic and in the free market, you know,
economy.
Korea.
But that was an eye-opener, wasn't it? To see that they really, really, really want unification, and they want it from both sides. You speak to North Koreans, they really want to be one great country again.
I think South Koreans are
the same. They want the one, they really miss each other almost.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it is one country. I think it's not like a breakup of the former Soviet Union where you have a lid on various nationalist instincts and cultures. This is a country that could be said to be artificially divided in 1954. And you know, was partly a sort of post-colonial, post-war America versus Russia proxy war.
It's almost as if Vietnam War ended in very rigid border called North Vietnam and South Vietnam. It's basically a very similar sort of story.
I think they tried, didn't they try in Vietnam? I understand from
Yeah, it didn't really work.
Anyway, there was a DMZ, which is allegedly a demilitarized zone, but the North Vietnamese never accepted the sense of a sort of pause or a ceasefire. But it's interesting, actually, having dug into some more history and culture since coming back, you know, the agenda clearly was to sort of bomb the North into submission and devastate it economically. And I think the recovery from the Korean War was incredibly hard in the North, you know. And that's why, in a way, Pyongyang is such a fascinating place, because, you know, it's a model city. It's a sort of urban planner's dream. And I've never seen such a sort of powerful execution of, you know, state architecture. Never ever seen anything like that.
The image is strong.
You frozen.
You're frozen a tiny bit, but then it's sort of increases.
Still...
I think it's just that, yeah, the day of Instagram is like that, unfortunately. Yeah. What's the biggest surprise? So what came out unexpected from the trip?
I think, you know, it's that classic thing of when you go somewhere where people are scared of or you've been warned of. I was lucky enough to go to Leningrad years ago during the midst of perestroika. You know, I was on an Aeroflot plane with about 12 other people that was empty. We landed. It was one of five flights a day. One was coming from New York. Leningrad was Leningrad, not St. Petersburg. You know, I remember having a sort of like a slight prickly sort of feeling of fear and anxiety, like I was sort of smuggling Levi's into, you know, there was a Levi's commercial at the time in which a guy smuggles a pair of jeans into a country. And sort of, you know, you feel this sort of, And in a way, going into the DPRK was similar in that, you know, and then sort of the minute you're in this totalitarian, Stalinist, workers' paradise, everything's normal. And we're just people, and they're just people. And so even though I know that, the experience of that was the biggest surprise. Do you know what I mean? You sort of... We come from Beijing and there's KFC and Starbucks. We're not aware that we're in a one-party state. because there are the trappings of consumerism. But when you then make the jump across, there's always that moment. I don't know what you're expecting. What are you expecting? It's like Big Brother, isn't it? It's like, what do we think they are going to be like, you know?
I have a question from Lucas. How do you research the country and conditions you're going to be in for something like that?
Well, that's really hard, isn't it? I mean, I think the production company did a, you know, risk assessment and a safety thing, and it was, you know, talking about various evacuation procedures should there be a nuclear war, and you sort of think this is kind of hilarious, really, you know. How, and on a personal level, like, you know, you try and research as much as possible in the time you have, but with a closed country that's notoriously secretive, that's incredibly hard. And you can read, you know, Amnesty reports and United Nations Human Rights Commissions, and sobering insight into how dissent is treated, and you can prepare for what you might consider to be a sort of surveillance state, whatever level that might be. But I think if you're going over there to follow the story, then you have to, in a way, step off the cliff and go, I'm going to fall through time and stuff's going to happen that I hope we can record. So while there was a plan of the kind of film we wanted to make and the kind of scenes we wanted to capture, until we were there, dream opposite of shooting a drama.
We had no idea what you're going to get. It's really breaking up. Yeah. I want to ask you, if you go back again, what would be the topic of your documentary?
So if I were to go back, I mean, at a superficial level, I really want to make a film about the architecture of the People's Republic of Korea. Yeah, I really want to, and this architectural style, who's designed it, how it's made, how it's built, and what it's like to live in these amazing buildings. But beyond that, which is quite a superficial idea, really, I'd want to do something about, I think, you know, something that would really connect you to, you know, the idea of inside People's Republic of Korea, because I think, you know, we were very outside, and I think inside should be, you know, the domestic experience of this. And of course, that's the thing that you would be so hard pushed to legitimately find or capture.
Carl, awesome to have you. Let's have a proper one later on, and hope, yeah, the internet, no one's fighting us stopping to talk. I'm going to add Thom Nicholson, who was my camera assistant, and also B-cam operator. So let's talk a little bit about filming. Hello. My question is, do you want to go back?
Yes.
Why?
I think I would want to go back, but with a shoot again, with a documentary, or with some sort of larger project, as the access that we had was quite insane in comparison to the other visitors who were shipped everywhere and, like, you know, just like herded here and there for 10 minutes. Whereas we had amazing access to all of these buildings, all of these places, almost unrestricted, to be honest with you. I mean, I'm sure you remember, they'd just drop us off in the place and they'd just sit and wait for us to do our thing. You know, nobody really walked behind me or behind you, you know, looking where we're going, because we're constantly back and forth. So I think I'd love to go back with another project just to have access, because the architecture is amazing, the spaces are huge, the mindset of the people is different, and also it's just amazing to go and visit a different dimension, if that makes sense. It's a bit cosmic, but I mean, I remember us speaking like how it was a surreal experience, because it's 2019 and we just got moved, you know, we moved back in time by like 50 years or something. I mean, would you want to go? Or forwards. I mean, would you want to go back yourself?
Yeah, absolutely. Like, and I keep telling that to everyone I meet and chat about the project is go. There is a way. I think it's the only company doing tours is Korea Tours. Even if it's not for a shoot, go. And I would go, say, go relatively soon. Just go if you can. Go for like a week, I think you can go. And it's safe. Just be sensible and respect.
Well, I think they have different packages. You have like a 7 or 14
day
package.
Yeah, I think the super short, there's like a weird one, which is like 4 days. And I think it's like a 10-day, then 21 day.
I mean, which 21. Four days is pointless. I mean, 10 days is perfect, I think.
We like selling North Korean tours. Tom, let's chat a little bit about the process. So Lucas was asking, how did you do prep? So prep. So we had different rentals on standby.
I think of course,
that, right?
Yeah.
So there was one in LA, I think, one in London, and one, and then in Beijing we ended up taking. And the biggest issue was no one would insure.
So no
one would insure kits, so we had to go with Beijing one because they're the only ones who would provide insurance.
Well, it wasn't just about insurance, it was like the staff, it was also like a political thing because you couldn't take almost anything American per se from America to North Korea. I mean, we took iPhones and shit like that, it's fine, but anything bigger, we couldn't, so that's why we didn't go with LA. London, we spoke to all the big houses, you know, Panavision, Ari, and OneStop, and all of these, like, Focus 24s and all of these other houses. Nobody wanted to insure it, because you didn't know whether it's going to come back, whether it's going to get confiscated. There's a story from, like, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, where that happened. So a lot of companies don't want to do it. And so, yeah, we went with Beijing, who do actually... China has this very odd relationship with NK.
They're kind of like slightly backdoor friends.
Backdoor friends.
Know, North Korea is under pretty insane layers of sanctions. I think there's 16 layers of sanctions, and you can really see them. You can see the place and even the capital, which is Pyongyang, suffering. Because I think it starts from, like, you can't manufacture, you can't import sports goods, and you can't import energy, so it's all has to be self-made, which I think they're struggling with. So there's some kind of stuff going on between some of the neighboring countries. But yeah, you could see it in sports goods as well, because we obviously filmed doc about sports. I remember seeing
I mean, yeah, all the sports equipment was like 20-30 years old, you know, like most of it. Or it looked like something made in the 90s, because almost not handmade, but you know what I mean. The factories making it weren't obviously up to
like simple stuff. Yeah, like
simple stuff.
Like,
yeah,
it's metal. Lift it.
But even talking to the guys like over there, there were like even toy parts, like parts for toys, weren't allowed to be exported or imported. And obviously, this all has its political reasons, but you can see what happens to a country once you cut off its influx and like outflow of produce.
Yeah.
It just dries up, you know, if it doesn't have its own resources.
What's your most vivid memory?
It's a bit of a weird one because it is the contradictory nature of Pyongyang itself. It's almost ordinary when you go there. It's almost like nothing special, which is the weird thing about it, because it's not the kind of ordinary that you and me know, that we were raised with. It's a different kind of ordinary. It's almost like this cliche, social realistic, frozen moment, but it's like, it's not really real. So I think what really struck me was just the day to day. I don't know how to call it, almost the mise-en-scene of it all, you know? But if it has to be something physical, I would say, the cold noodles that we had in this massive hall. We had such a weird conversation there on that table.
In this massive, echoey hall, where they serve basically one dish, which is national dish, which is cold noodles. So it's these grey cold noodles in a relatively cold soup, and to make it sort of tasty.
In
a cold place, you just sort of keep adding spices, and then suddenly it's kind of nice. And yeah, we spent like a good couple of hours.
It wasn't bad. But coming back to the prep question, just to be on a bit more technical, as people probably want that, our biggest worry was power, because we were not sure whether we can even charge anything. So as we heard about power cuts, so we took an insane amount of batteries, like no block, but V-logs, like on board. So we took like 32 batteries with us, just to power through. And we had enough power, but there were quite frequent power cuts. I mean, as you remember, like we were in the lift a few times and power just, you know, blackout.
I vividly remember the dinner with phone phone screens to illuminate, because for half an hour the electricity went, and I was in the basically the only hotel, the only of the two, I think, hotels for foreigners, which is basically like a 40-story high building, and when all the foreign runners came in, and there was a lot of them, more or less the whole hotel was full for 2 days. Electricity went off quite frequent, obviously, because devices, you need devices. So talking about tech, we shot on two cameras. So Thom was on B cam, picking up stuff like extra angles and B-roll. We shot on Alexa Minis brought from Beijing. We shot on Cook's
Pancros
set. Yeah, Cook Pancros. And then two zooms, and you knew...
I think they were Ari zooms.
Yeah, I'm looking
I was
at
Ari.
You're right. Yeah. Ari lightweight. Yeah, couple Ari lightweight.
Yeah,
zooms.
I think our long zoom was a 30-80, and we had the doubler, and we had like a 16-40, or is that the MGI? I can't remember. But
it's one basically of, that kind of like 16-40. I think it was actually 16-40 then. Day of marathon was split, so Thom stayed at the stadium. I went with the runners to capture the actual run. So each had the zoom and some of the primes. And that was, basic setup. We tried wireless work most of the times, so unless it's a relatively holy place, then wireless would cut.
Mysteriously.
And then, so director could monitor sometimes one, sometimes two cameras on a wireless monitor. And we had a Movi for kind of running stuff and had a car to shoot the running stuff off. There was one more question I wanted to ask you, Thom. I think it's another one from Anastasia, actually. This one. So did they restrict you in terms of where you could go, what you could do?
As I said before, we had quite unparalleled access, I think, in comparison to many other people. But we, yes and no. On a macro scale, yes, we were restricted to where we were driven to and taken to by our fixers. So they would drop us off at places where they deemed us to be not a threat to anything. Basically, the biggest threat for them was us spying, but we're spies.
And second, misrepresentation of what we filmed. They asked kind of person to person. They were like, can you please just not lie? Was basically their message, because they get, from what they kind of explain, they get fucked over and over that they let people film, and then it's kind of a massive expose. And I think that's what Carl did brilliantly here. It was filmed to what we're allowed to film, but also told the honest story of what girls saw. So Aimee and Mimi, who you can see on the screen right now, it's the other runner, and our sort of perception of what we encountered for basically almost 2 weeks. And then you make your own decisions from that. So I'm intrigued to know what they think of it. I'm really, really intrigued of what both our guides think of the film, and because I think it's relatively precise to what
I think so too. In relation to the restriction again, like when I was on B-cam in the stadium, when you went out to actually shoot the runners themselves, I was stopped once by like a soldier. Well, I can't cross this line and go like to that part of a stadium. But one of our fixers came up, our people were looking after us. He just asked about his number, walked away, had a phone call, and 2 minutes later, the soldier got a buzz in his radio to let me pass. And from that moment on, I had access to a full stadium without restrictions, apart from the judges' level. But I literally went everywhere, saw all those people, And I was hated by the media, but by their own reporters who were locked in this little box, now standing outside of it. And it was quite interesting. But we had good access, I think. We were pretty free.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think we were asked maybe a couple times to not film. And it was usually when you pick out something out of ordinary. So if it's slightly poorer person or a person on like a shittier bike or something, and they were asking it, and I would sometimes ask back, like, can you explain why? Of course, I will not film if you ask, but I would just like to know. And usually the answer was like, I don't want you guys to use it to show how bad everything is here. You know, I think that's the general answer, is like to kind of the image control.
I think so. The biggest thing is, I think they're very ashamed of the poverty that they are in. I mean, to be honest with you, we're in Pyongyang, which is the capital, so it would be the richest place. But in between the buildings and you know, in the backyards, you did see poverty. I mean, as Aimee said, everybody's walking everywhere because you cannot afford a car, like, ever. You're not earning anything. So, yeah, I think that's a big thing, saving face and the image. So, yeah. I mean, you just have to be sensitive, I think.
Yeah, totally. And I think have an honest chat. I think it's pretty clear what you're meant to have a chat about and what you shouldn't. Thom, thank you so much for joining us from the camera department, Extra Perspective. Thank you. And I'm going to add Ludo. This is Ludo Lasserre. He's the sound recordist who's done all sorts. We've done all sorts together, known each other for probably, what, over 10 years?
Yeah, 10, 12.
Do you want to go back?
Yeah, I would definitely. I before going, I did quite a lot of research and prep and stuff. And I spoke to two other recordists who had gone previously on jobs there. You know, one was on the Michael Palin thing and something else. And they both said the same thing. You know, I had some vague concerns, although not too much. I think on behalf of who we were working for, the Olympic Channel, you know, that was alleviating in many ways, I think. But I still did my work, and like they both said it was great, and I would go back in a flash. And my experience was, you know, exactly that as well. It was great. You know, it's one of the big reasons why I do this job. Really, we get to do lots of really weird travel, sometimes in really strange locations. Or you know, not necessarily locations, but strange situations as well that you wouldn't get access to normally. You know, like Thom was saying before. So you know, this definitely ticked that box. I mean, how many people do you know who can say I've been to North Korea? You know, we can say that now, and it was great. You know, and we've come back in one piece. You know, no problem at all.
Ordered coffee in North Korea.
Yeah. I mean, it's funny because like. You know, I'm not gonna lie. I remember on the first day, like getting in the hotel room, and I did like vague flip the mirrors and stuff like this just to check. But I mean, obviously there was nothing. But also equally on that, I think it was literally the very first night we went to the karaoke in the hotel and like blasting out, you know, Limp Bizkit or whatever, like you know, and having beer and stuff. So that was, I think by that point we were like, yeah, actually it's fine. No,
it was amazing to see that. Karaoke song list is same in every country. It's literally like this thick, has Limp Bizkit, has John Lennon's Imagine, has all sorts of songs.
Frank Sinatra,
Frank Sinatra, My Way, anything is in there. So yeah, we're like, sure, what was it, like $10 for 2 hours? Four of us just blasting tunes on first night in North Korea. It was interesting hotel as well. It was like a massive, massive, massive hotel, which was basically empty, apart from us, until the day marathon, when suddenly like something like 120 foreigners popped in.
Yeah, it was weird. I mean, you know, like a really different experience, like where you know you're used to sort of roam these corridors, like you know never see anyone in the lifts or whatever, and suddenly there's like yeah whatever it was, you know, 200 or something people in there.
Did you feel it? There was this weird sort of feeling where like wait, that's like our country, like we were like exploring it, just us for a week, and then suddenly there's all these foreigners coming in. It was like a weird feeling. Yeah, like, wait, it's like, well, there's more tourists than us. Why? It's this kind of strange sort of, ah, damn, bloody tourists. Charlie Herons asked this. It's not in the questions, unfortunately, but he did before. Were you careful of what you spoke about?
Yes, we were mindful. I mean, of course, it's going into there. It's one thing that we were aware of, and you know, like maybe more so than that. I mean, you know, we travel a lot anyway on the job, and wherever you go, obviously you're going to try and respect, you know, normal customs. We were aware more than usual to be obviously respectful, and I think by and large we were. You know, we didn't. I mean, you know, we. Maybe we relaxed a bit after a few days with our sort of fixtures as well, just because we had very normal, you know, like Carl said, once there, you're just people and they're just people, and actually everyone gets on quite well. I mean, you know, I don't know what would have happened if we had asked the wrong things or whatever, but we didn't feel, you know, we didn't do it at all. So I think it was in the back of the mind, but it wasn't really, it wasn't a worry, I would say. It was just something that, you know, that's just how you operated.
Tom is asking, and I was going to ask you that as well. So, Men in Black, first day of shoot, meant to roll the cameras at like 8, I think. What happens then?
The kid check in the hotel. I mean, to be honest with you, I was quite surprised how quickly and smoothly things went in the airport itself.
Yeah, that's true.
Compared to so many other, you know, and travel jobs where, you know, you just know. I mean, there's always a wide range of experience anyway, but usually you know how to allow time and stuff, and there it was very quick, mostly because our guys were there and just like overtook basically, and just, you know, got us through. But we were told that the next day, you know, people would come and check the kits and stuff, so first morning we had blocked out the entire half day, you know, not to shoot anything, whatever. We were told to put all the kits in one of the rooms at the hotel, and some guys came, I don't know, like 5 or 6 or 7, I can't really remember, you know, a bunch of guys came with like a big box.
In black, hence yeah. We're called the Men in Black.
Yeah. You know, fuck knows what was in the box, but they came and they went in the room and, you know, they looked everything thoroughly, and then like maybe an hour later they come out and they beckon Tom to go in there and to show them, you know, camera stuff. You know, he stays for, I don't know, an hour, 30 minutes or something, he shows them stuff, he then comes out. They spend more time there. They then come and get me, and I go in there and I show them, you know, they wanted me to show them radio mics and all this kind of stuff, you know, what frequency they could tune in or emit, or this, you know, things like this, essentially. I think, you know, once you show that, you know, you show them essentially what they wanted to see, or there was nothing shifty, it was fine. But they still, you know, again, they sort of sent me out and they spent another hour. I mean, like, all in all, it took that, I don't know, 4 or 5 hours or something.
Yeah, it took some time. And I remember you told me they asked you, so what frequencies can you sort of work on, listen? And I think your answer was like, any? And yeah. Then a bit sort of, you know, try not to. But the box was massive. We're talking like from the floor. It was like this sort of,
yeah.
Like two guys had to lift it and wheel it in. We had no idea what's in it.
I mean, it might have been empty for all we know. It might have been ultra, like, you know, which just we have no idea. And there might have been nothing going on.
A very good coffee machine. That's why they took it, and there was no good coffee in the hotel.
We knew what to expect, and it did set the tone that we had to play by the rules. And, you know, I think considering where we were, that was fine. You know, as a trade-off for having that kind of access. So that was fine, yeah.
A question I asked all four of you. What was the biggest, most vivid memory?
I mean, I, you know, it's been like, I think without a shadow of a doubt, the most surreal moment was the factory tour. And that's been mentioned already by Amy and others. So, you know, I won't talk too much more about it. I mean, it was weird, but anyway, I think the ping pong hall was another one for me, like sort of stepping into this like sort of massive gymnasium. And there's like rows and rows and rows and rows of ping pong tables, all busy. And you know, and like, by the way, they're good. You know, it's not like they're hitting the net every you know, 5 seconds. Like all of them, like full on rallies. And then, you know, as I said, an enclosed like reverberant gymnasium. So it sounds like you get in there, so you're surrounded by this sound. It was really, you know, especially for me, it was really impressive. So I, you know, I had good fun there. I went off on my own and like recorded lots.
Yeah, it's just like non-stop, like non-stop.
Noise.
So true. I'm just playing this just so that's amazing.
Sorry, yeah.
they have the story theory why so Koreans were together on the last two Olympics, I think, both winter and summer, I think. Yeah. So in it was summer, one unified team. The rumor is they allowed them to do it because Korea really, really, really wants to win China in table tennis, and the only way to do it is to have sort of mixed doubles between both Koreas, and there was sort of Olympic committee allowed to have it, to have proper battle between the two, because they're obsessed with table tennis.
I mean, from what I've seen, they have a chance, you know, they were good. The weightlifting hall was very impressive as well. I remember that. I think it was quite early on, maybe on day one or two. And you get in there, it's this really cool sort of like circular building, and you know, like weightlifters dotted around everywhere, and like they all have their sort of signature grunt when they do the actual lifting, which was really fun.
Someone's louder, someone's higher pitch.
Yeah, but it's like very different, but all of the like each one is the exact same one every time they lift. And it was kind of, it was bizarre, it was surreal. I loved it. It was great.
I remember there was kind of like a good camaraderie between those weightlifters. So they would all sort of group around the person lifting, and they'll be like, do it. They lift, both girls and boys, the lift, everyone's like, yeah, and they drop it. It was kind of like camaraderie in a queue. What surprised you the most? What was the something you didn't expect, and it was the way it was?
I think overall, I was maybe that came from having, you know, talked extensively before going to, you know, as I say, the recordists had gone there and stuff. I think I had a pretty good picture in mind of what it would or what it might be like. And by and large, it was kind of that. So nothing really. I think actually what Carl said is interesting, and it's probably very right. Actually, I was surprised by our feeling. Feeling quite comfortable very early on, actually, to be there, you know, again, as evidenced by the karaoke thing or this and that, just overall, not really straight. I mean, you know, we didn't log into any social media or anything like this, and, you know, we were careful with that. But, you know, it wasn't stressful at all, sort of day to day whilst doing the job. And maybe in a way that was, maybe it would surprise most people, I guess, because, you know, I suppose most people would say, wow, really, you went there and you weren't, you know, you didn't have second thoughts or something, and you know, we didn't fall.
Luz, thank you so much. So the film is on YouTube. It's called Running in North Korea.
Yeah. Good watch. It's 45 minutes. It's easily watchable, you know.
It's quite, and it's very kind of pacey. Carl did a great job. I'm going to disconnect you for a bit. I'm going to quickly check if there's any questions to ask on all things camera. Sorry for massive issues with tech in connecting, disconnecting. There's one sort of related to department as well I could answer. Anastasia is asking, how would you have tackled big equipment problems if something would have needed replacement? Basically, we took as much as possible with us. So we had two cameras, we had a bunch of prime lenses, two zooms, and like Thom mentioned, 32 batteries. So that was kind of it. We couldn't really do much more around that. We had some GoPros, would have, I guess, continued shooting in GoPros. So I think equipment-wise, it would have been okay, I think. Thank you so much for tuning in. Thank you for staying till the end. And it's going to be on IGTV right now for, I think, 24 hours, and then I bosh it onto the YouTubes. Thank you so much, and have a lovely evening.